Welcome to G Media Lesson Review, where we go in depth into the Word of God each week from the Glendevon Seventh-day Adventist Church. And as usual, you can reach us by our Facebook, which is Seventh-day Adventist Glendevon, or our YouTube page, which is Glendevon SDA. This evening, I have in studio with me two of our elders of the Glendevon Seventh-day Adventist Church. We have Elder Kevin Faulkner, Elder.
Thank you, sir.
And Elder Arkins.
Thank you.
Yes. Now, these two gentlemen are men of God. They spend time in the Word. And tonight we want to go into the lesson that we have for this quarter. Now, last quarter was a wonderful one. Now we are on a new quarter, which is the Holy Spirit and spiritual gift. But before we go into the Word, we want to ask.
Heavenly Father, we are grateful that you are spirit of our life to see 2017. As we hope in your Word tonight, oh God, let your Holy Spirit come upon us. We ask in Jesus' name.
Amen. The topic that we were looking at for this week is this Spirit and the Word. Gentlemen, the Spirit and the Word. What a topic to start the year with. We know that the Spirit of God is one that not always strive with men. But this week we will see how the Spirit of God work out its way in the life of men and in the Bible. Now let us look at the quarterly for this week, the memory verse. The memory verse for this week, which comes to us from 2 Timothy 3, 16 and 17.
All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness.
Yes.
That the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work.
Yes. Now, it says all scripture is given by inspiration of God, and it is profitable for doctrine. What do you mean by profitable for doctrine? What's doctrine is to us? Any gentleman know? No?
The belief of the church is described as our doctrine.
Yes.
And all the belief of a church must be by scripture and scripture only.
Yes. And reproof.
Well, when you look on reproof, you know, the Bible speaks to the fact that whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth.
Yes.
And so from time to time, being Christian, we may err, you know, it could even be a matter of rebellion. Mm-hmm. And so reproof is a strong level of rebuke or a strong level of correction. It's not, you know, whereby we just merely correct an individual, but it is a strong level of correction or seeking to put one or to highlight to one the correct path to traverse.
Yes. And for instruction in righteousness. And that's something that we all need to get instruction in righteousness, because we can all say that we are living right, but without the correct instruction,
definitely.
Then we might. So the memory verse is it says a whole lot.
Yes, the memory verse, the first word there in that text, all,
yes,
scripture, not just the Old Testament,
mm-hmm,
but all scripture, both Old and New Testament,
mm-hmm,
are inspired by God.
Yes.
So those who live off the Old Testament say it is for them. Really, we don't understand the true message that all of the scripture, both Old and New Testament, were given by God for instruction in righteousness. If we are to live a righteous life, we have to understand God.
Yes.
And by understand God, we have to understand the Word of God. And that is through the scripture.
Yes, thank you very much, Ella. And we as a church, we get our instruction from the Word. And when we have a text like this that tells us that all of the scripture is there for, to teach us, to correct us, to reprove us. You know, it's comforting to read the scripture then. And because such, we want to turn to 2 Peter 1:19. 2 Peter 1:19-20. What do you gentlemen want to read that for?
20?
Yes.
And it says, we have also a more sure word of prophecy.
Yes.
Whereunto he do well that he take heed,
mm-hmm.
as unto a light that shineth in a dark place until the day dawn, and the day start arise in your hearts, knowing this first, that no prophecy of the scripture is of any private interpretation.
Mm-hmm.
For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost.
So the scripture have, within the scripture there are prophecies. And the prophecies are for us. They were received by men who were inspired, as the scripture said. You want to say something?
I want to look at, we have a more sure word.
Yes.
Of prophecy.
More sure word.
If I'm not certain that my name is Kevin Faulkner.
Mm.
If I'm not certain that I live where I say I live.
Yes.
But I'm certain that this is the word of God.
Mm-hmm.
We have a more sure word. If anything I'm not certain of,
yes.
I'm certain that this is the word of God.
The word of God.
Definitely.
And there's no room for doubt in God's word.
No.
There's evidence all over about how the word of God has fulfilled. It's a matter of how we have texts upon texts which we can quote to show where God's word, where the prophecies fulfill. Let's look at Daniel 2:19.
Then was the secret revealed unto Daniel in a night vision. Then Daniel blessed the God of heaven. Daniel answered and said, blessed be the name of God forever and ever, for wisdom and might are his. And he changeth the times and the seasons. He removeth kings and setteth up kings. He giveth wisdom unto the wise and knowledge to them that know understanding. He revealeth deep and secret things. He knoweth what is in the darkness, and the light dwelleth with him. 23, I thank thee and praise thee, O thou God of my fathers, who hast given me wisdom and might, and hast made known unto me now what we desire of thee, for thou hast now made known unto us the king's matter. And of course, we understand the context of the story.
Yes.
That King Nebuchadnezzar had a dream which troubled him. Of course, he made mention that the thing had left him.
Mm-hmm.
So he was only aware that he had a dream, but wasn't sure. And he inquired from all those who served him, the magician, the soothsayers, the Chaldeans, and all the others who claimed that they had the ability to interpret dreams. But all of them failed.
Yes.
And then the thing was made known unto Daniel. You know, it is... when you analyze the story, the account rather, when Daniel heard of the issue, he was not able to tell the king what was the issue. He never knew, you know, what was a dream or whatever. So, you know, it just highlighted to us some level of inability,
mm-hmm.
on a man by himself, whereby,
yes.
you know, within and of himself, he was not able to go in unto the king and say, King, I know what the dream is, and I know the interpretation.
Yeah.
But from this account, we realize that he went to God.
God, yes.
And he made the thing known. Well, I wouldn't say make known, because God already knew. And he inquired of God, what was the issue all about? And here Daniel was giving thanks to God for having revealed
yes.
the thing to him.
Revelation.
And yes. that was indeed remarkable.
Of course. Yes.
And it's good to know, because when you take note of the story, the other wise men could not reveal it. And one of the reasons why they could not reveal it, they normally hear the dream and come up with something.
Mm-hmm. To appease the king.
Yes. In this case, the king don't remember it. And Daniel did not know that when he started to tell the king would have said, ah, that is the dream. You never know that. But because he depended on God, God revealed it to him.
Yes.
Now, the Bible said that this Holy Spirit reveal and inspire. Could you tell us a little about this old revelation of the scripture?
Revelation is the process of which God make himself known to man.
Yeah, just like his will to Daniel.
Yes, it's about an unveiling or uncovering the hidden thing of God. It's true revelation. So God, man don't know the right path to take. Without God and his direction, man will be lost. So it must be through some form of revelation that God reveal his will to man that man can truly take this path to tread in.
Yes, and also he say the Apostle Peter said a prophetic message of the Old Testament was not of human origin, but it was inspired.
Yes,
it was inspired. Larkins, before we go, can you tell us a little about inspiration? What is the whole? We know when things are revealed, but what about inspiration? When you are inspired,
good. Well, inspiration works whereby God seek to influence the thought process of man.
Yes.
You know, many times we sit down and we say that, you know, we make a decision and we say, boy, you know, the Spirit just tell me to do this. And I did it. And we can see that indeed the outcome was good. That was a way through which God had inspired us to make a particular choice. So inspiration is the way through which God works along with the human agent. You know, it's a connection with the mind, or even using the things around us that can seek to influence us. And through this, we make decision. Through this, we transmit messages that God really wants to impart to other people. So inspiration, especially within this context, it is not a matter of, even though I may come and I say something in particular, it's not necessarily my words, but I was inspired to say it.
Yes.
You know, it's not something that I just thought about and I came up with it. Mm-hmm. I was inspired by God. God worked through me as a human agent to transmit whether a particular message or whatever the issue may be. And this, of course, is a medium through which God seeks to work and to reveal many things to us as individuals through inspiration.
And we want to look at a text that brings out how God inspire someone to a prophet. Let's look at Deuteronomy 18, verse 18.
All right, we'll look at.
And it says, I will raise them up a prophet from among thy brethren, like unto thee, and will put my word in their mouth, and he shall speak them all that I shall command him. So here is a prophet being inspired to with the word of God. God put his word in his mouth. That's one way. That's one way God inspires someone.
Yes, you're
saying.
The process in which the scripture was even written.
Yes.
Man did not write exactly word to word what God said.
Yes.
But God inspired them to their thought. And man write according to what they understand at the word of God.
Yes.
And so when you find, and so amazing, when you find that the four gospel, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, different contexts of the same story.
Definitely.
But all have the one meaning.
Yes.
And the one objective.
Mm-hmm.
When you search the scripture, and it was written about 1500 year period. But it all have the same theme, and none of the writer contradict each other. It must be the will of God.
Yes.
It must be God directing what he wants.
You know, yeah. Even when we look at examples of preachers, oftentimes we hear one or two preach. As a matter of fact, all the sermons that we have been hearing throughout our lives, they have all been repeated. You know, but when you look at it, different preachers take it from different perspectives.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
They bring it across different, using different methods, different ways. But at the end of it, the story does not change, or the objectives, they still remain the same. It's just that they may do it in a different way. So as Elder Faulkner is saying, that when God inspired them to pen the words,
mm-hmm.
you know, it was not written directly how God gave it to them, because they were now to interpret in a matter where, in a way through which human beings we are able to relate to it. And so, you know, it was able to be written, you know, as how they were inspired.
Yes.
So that is how the Lord really seek to inspire us. And of course, you know, we are inspired differently.
Yes.
But, you know, as what Elder Faulkner said.
Now, in the Bible, there are persons who at times would be lost for words. And God is saying that he is, you don't have to worry. Like Samuel's, and you don't have to worry. I will put my words in your mouth.
Yes.
That's a way of inspiration as well. Eh? God will give you what to say.
Definitely.
Don't worry about what to say. God will give you what to say. I don't know, you guys are preachers. Is there any time when you are up there preaching and something that is not a part of your script, but it just, God just put in something in there and give you exactly what to say?
The Bible says he will bring back all things to our remembrance.
Yes.
And that is important.
It's important.
Remembrance.
Yes.
You know, even from my own experience, I mean, you may be inspired to write a particular message.
Mm.
And, you know, it even shows some of your own imperfection when you're preparing that message. Because when you go up there to present that message, which in your own mind you thought was perfectly put together,
mm-hmm.
the Lord just reveals something else unto you.
Of course. Yes.
I mean, it was not there, even if you're following a script or even if you're guided by a some texts. Mm-hmm. The Lord just inspire you to say something. And somebody can even relate that, I mean, that particular thing that you said, you know, they really gathered something from it, you know. So the Lord just knows to work, and, you know, what he wants to be achieved, he'll just inspire us in spite of even our own agenda.
Yes.
He'll just inspire us to say what he knows will meet the objectives.
All right. Now, there's a text here I want to share. 2 Samuel 23 and verse 2. 2 Samuel 23 verse 2. And it says that the Spirit of the Lord speak within me. His word is on my tongue. The Spirit of the Lord speak within me. His word is on my tongue. What Samuel is saying here, that when you're preaching just the same, or you're giving a testimony, and God's Spirit is within you, and once you talk according to the Bible, His word is on your tongue. Is that it, or is something more? I just want to.
Well, of course, as Samuel is speaking about the word, you know, Samuel, of course, one who serves the Lord, and the Lord would often give him messages,
yes,
to deliver to the people. And, you know, oftentimes, persons are not really favorable to the messages that patriarchs and prophets and even priests often bring to them. They may even cry for different word. But oftentimes you hear them say that, listen, I will only speak that which the Lord give to me.
Yes.
And so Samuel was making it known that whatever I'm coming to you with, it is not my word. It is not something that I went to bed and I thought about that, hey, I want to talk to the people today, so I'm going to write down a script. And it is whatever God put in his mouth that he's going to say. And it worked just the same with preparing a message, because, you know, we are going to be talking to God's people.
Yes.
We don't know what they need to know. Well, we might, you know, have some understanding of the challenges that they are really going through. But you think about it, it's a great multitude of people. But God really knows what everybody really need from a particular message. And so he will put it in your mouth, on your tongue. And if, of course, you're obedient, you'll be able to deliver what God says and not necessarily what you want to say to the people.
And so it then is important that, mm-hmm. the preacher, the man of God, depend upon the word of God.
Yes.
You have to read the word of God to have the understanding what God wants you to say to your people. It's not my talk.
Mm-hmm.
It's not what I feel to say. It's not my doctrine. But it comes from thus saith the Lord God.
Definitely.
So God will inspire his people to correct the church or to correct their own life. And all of this have to come from the word of God. So we have to spend more time. As you mentioned earlier, that it will bring back to memory.
Yes.
You know, bring back to memory as to what to do and what to say. So as we are imploring you viewers that the studying of the word of God is important. We must study God's word for us to live according to the will of God. There's no way you can live according to the will of God and not knowing God's will. Because the Holy Spirit will not come and put in your head something that he already revealed for us to know, and you don't spend time to know it. So let us study God's word. Now we want to look at the Holy Spirit and the truthfulness of the scripture. The Holy Spirit and the truthfulness of the scripture. Now, many persons out there say a number of things about the scripture. And at times they want to say that a man write the Bible. A man write the Bible, so man put what they want to put in it. But we are what you're saying too is that the scripture is a matter of memory verse. Point out where the scripture is inspired.
Yes.
The scripture is inspired. And in our lesson there's a text there, Psalms. So
Brother Coy, we'll not argue the fact that indeed it was written by man.
Mm.
We won't argue the fact indeed it was.
It was, yes.
But it was not man's word.
No.
The man were just merely the instrument being used in, you know, it's almost like, I mean, I want to write or I want to prepare a speech and I have somebody sitting down and listening to and I'm telling them some of the things that I want to talk about.
Mm-hmm.
And I just say to them some of the things that I want to address.
Yes.
And they will basically pen the word for me and I will go and, you know, I will go and read it. It's still my words, even though I was not, it's my word,
mm-hmm.
but I was not the one who wrote it.
Yes.
So they wrote the words, but it's not theirs. Is God's word written by man?
Yes.
The Bible said that the word of God is alive, mm-hmm. and active, and is sharper than any two-edged sword. The word of God is so alive in the Christian life. And as a Christian, you no need to have judgmental upon the word of God.
Mm.
It's best if you accept the scripture as the God will. And God revealing his will to you, then accepting the scripture will come easy.
Mm.
Because by faith, we understand God. And listen, without faith, we cannot truly understand the scripture.
Mm-hmm.
We have to understand it through faith, that God is revealing his will to us. And it is alive and is active in us. Jeremiah says it's like a fire. Shut up in my bones.
Yes.
And so when you accept the scripture, it's there to guide you in the way that God wanted to go.
So none of us should just take up the scripture just to mere read casually without asking the Holy Spirit to help us while we read the scripture. Because the Holy Spirit lead us into all truth, and the word of God is truth. So what would you say to someone who say that they are reading and they are not getting from the scripture, they are understanding the scripture?
Well, I guess you want to look on, you know, some attributes of the Spirit, whereby the Spirit serves, you know, as a teacher. But even before I address that issue, we look on the Holy Spirit, the truthfulness,
yes.
you know, even of the scripture itself. You know, the point was mentioned earlier that there have been so many Bible writers. I mean, you check from Genesis all the way to Revelation.
Mm-hmm.
There are so many Bible writers and there are so many biblical accounts. But still, there is no evidence of contradiction.
Yes.
All of them still work hand in hand. The Bible itself tells us about the character of God, whereby it says that it is impossible for God to lie. Impossibility with God is a word that I don't really like to use. I often say that it is against the nature of God to lie. So it is not within him. And if it is the word of God, you know, written to us, you know, it would be for us to take away from his character to say that error or lies are written therein. If we are saying that the word is God's,
yes,
and we are saying that error is there, then we are necessarily attacking the very character of God himself, because God revealed himself to us in his scripture, and the scripture tells us about him. And the Bible itself made mention that, as I made reference to a while ago, that it is impossible for God to lie. And the Spirit is there to teach us, to lead us, you had made mention earlier, in all truth
yes.
and righteousness,
yes.
not in error. And if you look on it, oftentimes when we fall into error, we can trace it to something that we did against the scripture. When we did so, when we perform a particular deed and it is right or correct, when we trace it back to the scripture emphasizes on it. When we go contrary, we fall into lie, we fall into error. So anything outside of the Spirit working, that can be classified as something with error or something with lie. But where the scripture and the Holy Spirit is concerned, indeed, it is truth. And of course, there are a number of other truths that are there. We look at St. John 17, verse 17. It says, sanctify them through thy truth. What is truth?
Thy word.
It says, thy word
is truth.
Is truth.
Yes.
So we cannot put lie with the word of God. You know, even though some may seek to do so, but I mean, that is not supported by scripture.
Yes.
But you realize that over and over again, every day, we will come upon people who won't believe the Bible, who won't say they believe the Bible, and say they accept the Bible, but they reject certain things of the Bible.
Yes.
Some don't believe in a literal seven-day creation. Some don't believe in a virgin birth. Some may not believe in that there were really a flood. But I'm saying, if you accept the Bible and say it is the word of God, why then reject some and accept some? That's the problem we have now, even with Christendom. We also believe the one Bible. But we all have different beliefs, and we accept what comfort us and what suit us.
Yes.
But reject what we don't want to have. And listen, if you're going to accept the word of God, all scripture.
All
scripture is given by inspiration. And it's property for doctrine and for report.
I wonder why God didn't inspire the men in writing this theme of the Bible supporting itself. Why didn't he say that the scripture is written?
Yes.
He didn't just left it like that for you to choose and say, this particular text is the one of which it is speaking of. Or this particular Bible writer is the one. But he used a word which includes everything. Nothing is exempt. Not even a little a letter. Our one word, but everything he said, it is there as my word, and it is truth all the way from Genesis all the way down to Revelation. Everything the Bible speaks of is indeed truth. And of course, there are a number of other texts there. If you wanted us to look on a few other, for example, St. John chapter 14, verse 17, speak about even the Spirit of truth.
Yes.
And we are talking about the Holy Spirit here. It says that the Spirit of truth. So the Spirit is not a spirit that leads one into error. As a matter of fact, remember Jesus made mention that when he was preparing to go back to heaven, he made mention that he would send a comforter, and the comforter would lead us into all truth and righteousness. That was one of the things that he said about the comforter, which is the Holy Spirit. They say, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but he know him, for he dwelleth with you and shall be in you. And we asked a question earlier, which I believe as we go down in the lesson, it will help us to understand why sometimes that we really have problem with the Word of God, why we want to choose some and to, you know, exclude some.
Mm.
So, you know, he points out to that it's not necessarily the Bible that the problem is. Rather, it is with us.
With us.
Somebody wrong.
Yeah.
But not the Bible.
You know, as you made mention of that, oftentimes I wonder, in a classroom setting, different students may have different things to say about a particular teacher. Mark you, the teacher teaches in a whole group.
Yes.
But you may hear one come and say they don't like the teacher. Another come and say, I like the teacher. Mm-hmm. One come and say the teacher don't teach good. One will come and say the teacher teach good.
Mm-hmm.
But still, it was the same teacher. And it was just one whole setting.
Mm-hmm.
So there must be something, not necessarily with the teacher, but there must be something with the student themselves, because not everybody is in agreement with what the teacher. Some is saying that he's good, some is saying that he's bad. So perhaps it could be then that the ones who are claiming that he's not teaching good or she's not teaching good is not really applying him or herself to the learning.
Yes. Well, yeah, according to the text, so you just read in St. John 14, it also points out that the word cannot see him, the world cannot see him because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but he know him, for he dwelleth within you. So those who are in Christendom, who spend time reading upon the word, will know God and know his word. But those who don't read his word won't know him and won't understand. And that's why you will have persons will say things like the Bible have error in it. And you would ask them where the error is. They not even know where the error is. They just talk out of mere talking. But when you spend time within the word of God, all you will find is truth. And it will fulfill your life, and it will teach you. Now the Holy Spirit help in teaching. How does the Holy Spirit aid in teaching? We just discovered that the Holy Spirit aid in the writing of the Word of God. But how you aid in teaching?
As we made mention earlier, we asked the question in terms of how is it that sometimes we claim that there are errors, or how we go about understanding? Because, you know, even when you look at it, sometimes as Christian we are explaining the word, and someone who is just there being an onlooker or a listener, they are like, I read the same thing and I didn't get see that. I mean, I did not get that, no at all. Where did you see that? How do you see that? I read it over and over. But of course we realize that with the scripture itself, there has to be a connection with the scripture and with the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
Because throughout the Bible, we'll get to understand that there is something with us as individuals. So there is a problem with us.
Yes.
So as a result, we are not able to get what is really there. And so that is where the Holy Spirit comes in. Where the Holy Spirit is the one that is going to now help us to really understand. You know, the Bible made mention of the fact that spiritual things are spiritually discerned. So as a Christian, my approach to the Word of God is, I am going to study a particular text or a particular chapter. My first approach is to go to God in humility and to go to him to understand that he is the God of all truth, of all knowledge and understanding. So I will ask him to grant me his Holy Spirit, that he may reveal unto me the things that are there in the scriptures, the things that within and of myself I can't really understand, read as I may, try as hard as I may. But the Holy Spirit is there as a teacher. And as we look at a teacher, we look within a classroom setting. Students need teacher. Because the students do not know, they don't have the knowledge of the thing. But the teacher has the knowledge, so it is with the Holy Spirit. We don't know.
Yes.
We are ignorant. Our heart is always fighting against God's word. So we need the Holy Spirit now to help us to understand, to break it down to us, because it is spiritual. The Word of God is not like any normal book that you just take up and read and answer comprehension. It is a spiritual book, and it requires the Holy Spirit to help us to understand.
All right, the role of the Holy Spirit and Scripture is a theme of what we are studying here.
Yes.
We cannot understand the will of God truly without the Holy Spirit.
Without the Holy Spirit.
We cannot understand the Bible and the God word in it unless we have the Holy Spirit in our life. What we are saying, sinful human being studying the word of God, prefer for us not to follow.
That's our preference.
Yes. Sinful human being prefer for us not to follow God's will. So without the aid of the Holy Spirit to help us to understand the will of God, then whatever we read, we will not get it of what God is saying.
Yeah.
So the Christian life cannot live truly as a Christian without the aid of the Holy Spirit. So we need the Holy Spirit to guide us even in His Word.
Good, definitely. You know, as I look here, I'm looking at a particular text that was utilized in the lesson. Ephesians 4 verse 18, it says, having the understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God through the ignorance that is in them. And it's, of course, it's speaking to people.
Yes.
Because of the blindness of their heart. This is our condition. This is what the text is saying.
Yes.
That our understanding, it is darkened.
Darkened. Yes.
When we go to the Word of God, as I made reference to the, you know, a common person or a man who is not really a committed believer in God, just reading, and the one who believes understands, our understanding is darkened. And as the Bible says, that spiritual things
are
spiritually discerned.
Yes.
So we cannot really, we are accustomed to darkness, error, wrongs. That is what we know. And so to go to this book, which is light, we're not going to really comprehend anything. So that is where the Holy Spirit comes in to guide us now, to help us, and to reveal, to open our understanding. You know, we look on Daniel earlier. When Daniel was not able to understand, he never knew the dream, neither was he able to understand it. He went to God, and God revealed it unto him, and he was able to bless God for revealing unto him. That is how the Spirit works. Reveal it unto us, because we will not know of ourselves. As much as we may read, we won't understand, we won't get it, we won't want to practice it. But that is where the Holy Spirit comes in as our teacher.
Now, the Holy Spirit and the Word, the Holy Spirit who have revealed and inspired the content of the Bible to human being, will never led us contrary to God's word in any way. Once we accept, thus said the Bible, in as we read it, we will always go according to God's will. Now, the lesson have a whole lot to say. I'm getting the wrap-up signal, but just give me your take on this as we put a close to the study of the Word, the Holy Spirit and the Word.
Well, for me, when I look and analyze this lesson, it does highlight to me the necessity that as a Christian we must seek to possess the Holy Spirit and to have the Holy Spirit with us all the time. Because as a lesson highlight, as a theme of this quarter's lesson, the Holy Spirit and spirituality. Mm-hmm. I mean, you cannot grow in Christ. You cannot understand, you know, the will of God unless there is the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. That is what drives us. That is the power behind us living righteous lives.
John 5 and verse 39. It said that you must study the scripture.
Yes.
Make sure. It said, search the scripture, for in them ye think ye have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me. If we're going to have eternal life, we have to study the scripture.
Yes.
And Christ is saying, the theme of the scripture is me.
Yes.
The message of the scripture that you're studying is me.
Yes.
So study the scripture. Because the only way you can have eternal life is by studying the word of God.
Yes. And in closing, I want to share with us viewers here. It says that the Holy Spirit is never given to replace the word of God. He rather work in harmony with the true, in harmony and through the Bible to draw us to Christ. So we are not to say that we have the Spirit, because the Spirit is truth and we don't need to read the Bible. No, but the Holy Spirit work in harmony with us as we study God's word. And when we come upon situation, it will bring to our remembrance the truth, so we can make right decision and also correct person where they are wrong, because we study the word. Now I want us to, it's a good way to start the year.
Yes.
A good way to start the quarter. Study God's word and allow the Holy Spirit to reveal God's truth in us. That's what we want for our viewers and for all of us, to study God's word and let it reveal the truth to us. And when the truth is revealed, then we will start to walk aright. The foolish mistake that we made, that we make throughout last year, we will not make it this year, because we will be walking in the will of God.
And what a lesson to come at the start of 2017.
Yes.
The Holy Spirit and spirituality. If we're going to have a good Christian life,
yes,
we must have a spirituality in us. We must live according to the Spirit. And we must have the Holy Spirit within us to have that good spiritual life.
Yes.
And so I say, the theme for this year is to turn a new page.
Mm-hmm.
And for you to turn a new page, you need the Spirit to be spiritual. What a theme. What a message.
Why? Elder Hawkins, please pray and ask God to help us to do what is right.
Father in heaven, the Word of God of truth, the Word of God of light, and we thank you for having revealed yourself unto us through your words. And even though we have been alienated by sin, you have sent your Spirit, O God, to be our teacher. Make us faithful students of your word. May as we understand, may we live aright. May you guide us, Heavenly Father. May you bless us. May you be with our viewers. May even as we go throughout this year, may we have a deeper and a more meaningful relationship with you, even as we grow more so spiritually. Bless us now unto the end, we pray. In Jesus' name.
Remember, viewers, you can reach us by our Facebook. Remember, viewers, you can reach us by our Facebook page at Seventh-day Adventist Glendevon, or our YouTube page at Glendevon SDA. Until next time, God, may God go with you.